Okay, we are live. Hello, everyone. I see a bunch of people in the chat. Hi, everyone. I think I got my first couple seconds cut off. I'm flying solo today, unless Sarah pops in unexpectedly, because it is kind of a holiday here in the United States today. So I want to say hi to everyone. We have some wonderful moderators in the house today that will help you if you have any questions. And I will be peeking up at the chat throughout the broadcast today, so I can hopefully catch some of your questions, but I will take some time out at the end of the painting so I can go through any of the tail end questions that come in. So I will do my best. Just keep in mind, I am flying solo today, and we're going to get right into it. We're going to start off with watercolors. I've already sketched this out, and I do have the pattern on my blog. The link is in the video description. The colors we're going to use are from the Turner Artist Watercolor line. You can use whatever brand you prefer. These come from our sponsor, Jerry's Artorama, who has their brand new holiday sale happening right now. And if you go to their website and type in stocking stuffers, you will see tons of $1 and $2 try it samples. They have some of the Turner paint. They have some of the Mimic watercolor brushes that I love. They have a lot of wonderful things that you can try for a buck or two right now, which is a lot of fun. And they're our sponsor, and I thank them for their support. And I also want to let you know that Craftsy has their biggest sale of the year going on right now. The prices are the lowest of the year, and my class is on sale for $13.99 if you want to check that out. Links to that are in the video description as well. We're going to use something that I forgot to mention when I first published my blog post today. We're going to use some salt at some point today in the background to give it the look of softly falling snow. I just have a bag of kosher salt here, but table salt is totally fine. And I apologize for forgetting to put that in the description when I first published it this morning. I accidentally sketched on the wrong side, the back side of my Fabriano paper. So we're going to see how that works. It should be fine because I actually a lot of times will end up painting on the back side of my scraps, and it always seems to work all right. So we're going to start off with a nice juicy brush. I'm going to go with my favorite Mimic number 30 round. That's available in a set or individually at Jerry's. I've taped down my paper, so I'll have a nice border. But actually, before I taped it down, I managed to smear some Viridian Green because I stuck my finger in it on my palette before I started. So, you know, I got a little mess under one of my corners, but it'll be covered by a mat. I'm not worried about it. So I am going to wet around my deer that I sketched, but I am going to go over the holly. I want my deer to be the sharpest in focus, most in focus thing on the painting. So I'm going to avoid wetting that. You guys can all hear me, right? Could you let me know in the comments that you guys can all hear me? Because like I said, flying solo here, flying blind. I just have the chat open in on another computer. I don't have the player going, so I don't want to get distracted while I'm working. And I had just sketched this on with a regular pencil. I have my paper taped down to a board, and that way if I need to tip it at all, I can do that. So I just have to make sure I don't have anything on it, but I can tip it to see where it's shiny and where I have wet and where I haven't. Oh, good. Everyone can hear. Phew, thanks, guys. I'm really depending on my moderators today. Now I'm going to want a fairly soft background, so I'm going to want to make sure that my my paper is not super shiny, that it's just kind of damp. So I might need to blot it a little bit, or because this is a super juicy brush, or I might just have to let the paint soak in a little bit. Hopefully painting on the reverse side of this paper is not going to give me any issues. All right. Now what I'm doing here is I'm just soaking up any puddles I see, because if you blot your brush like on a paper towel, then you can go in and you can soak up any puddles. I find it's a little bit, it works a little bit better than using a paper towel, because then you don't end up over drying an area. So I just want like a satin sheen on my paper. All right. So I am going to take some ultramarine blue and I got some burnt sienna in there. I'm just going to pick up a little bit of burnt sienna with the ultramarine blue. And I'm going to put some of that gray just in the background. I want kind of to have like some snowy hills, but I don't want it to be really, I don't want anything to be really distinct in the background. And I am going to let some of the color go on top of the holly that I put in there. And if you don't want to do holly, you could have a springtime meadow. That would be totally fine if you don't want to do a winter scene. I'm going to do a little bit of blue in the sky. So I'm just going to take the ultramarine blue. And I think I'm going to add a little bit of rose to that. Put some of that in the sky as well. Because that could be sky, or it could be kind of trees off in the background. So you might be wondering, if you have a full sheet of paper, what's the right side and what's the wrong side? The right side has the watermark on it, but if you cut your paper down, you might not have that watermark on the piece that you're working. This one actually did have the watermark on it, but I completely ignored it until after I'd already sketched it on, and I decided to see what would happen because I'll have a teachable moment here. I'm going to take a little bit of this purpley color I have, and I'm just going to add it down here at the bottom. I could see that this is absorbing way more than it would if I was working on the opposite side, but we're going to roll with it. And I'm going to grab a little, I'm going to pick up that puddle right there with my dried off brush, and I'm going to grab a little bit of burnt sienna. So you can have a little bit of life. I'm going around areas in the background. And I'm going to grab a little bit of sap green, so it could have a little bit of life poking through here and there. Gonna have something for our deer to eat, so we don't want it to be too barren. Now hopefully the salt technique will work on this. I'm thinking I might want to actually throw in on the horizon, just do maybe a little bit of burnt sienna back there, maybe to be signify some trees. Maybe do a little sap and a little ultramarine. Give some evergreens in the background, just kind of soft and out of focus. Because we got to have some color in there if we're going to do our technique with the salt. Little ultramarine, little sap green. And that is just going to also be easier to lift than if I used a viridian or a phthalo green, because those colors tend to stain a little bit more. And I think now I'm going to sprinkle on the salt, and hopefully it will react with this paper well enough. But if you do get that situation where you're working on nice quality paper and you're like, geez, it's just not, it feels like the paint is just sinking in and it's not staying on top. It could be that you have using on the wrong side of the paper. So you could always let that dry or dry with the heat tool and start painting on the back side. I see you guys sharing some Black Friday deals in the chat. That's awesome. Help each other out. We all like to get some deals. I did a little Black Friday shopping last night. Nothing too major online. I don't brave the stores. I'm not that brave. I'm just blowing the salt off of the deer. I'm gonna see if I can tap it gently, because sometimes if you use like a heat tool to speed up the salt process, you'll get it won't be as dramatic, so I don't want to do that. So now I'm going to start working on the deer, and I'm going to go with a smaller brush. I'm going to take this big one out of the water so I don't have a problem there, and I am going to start washing in some light colors. I'm going to start with some yellow ochre. I'm going to clean up an area on my palette though, because kind of filled it up here. I'm going to grab some yellow ochre and some burnt sienna. Quite a bit of water. And I'm going to start with a wash on the deer. I'm going to do the lightest areas first. And I did sketch out some spots. And I realized that probably you wouldn't have fawns out in the winter. They would be old, probably outgrown their spots by now, but I just thought that was sweet, and I wanted to do that. So I'm just painting around the spots that I sketched. adding lots of water to make it light enough. And this is also, if you're working on a paper that's maybe not a good quality watercolor paper, maybe you're working in a sketchbook, this technique is going to work fine. I'm going to pretend that this paper is not a good quality paper because I'm working on the backside and I can tell it's not behaving already like my normal paper. I've never noticed Fabriano to be one-sided, but it is feeling kind of that way today. So and this is also the soft press, which is a combination. It's kind of like in between cold press and hot press. And I don't think I realized I had soft press at the beginning when I was working. And so I was looking at the, I was using the rougher side, which is pro, which I think their backside's a little rougher than the front side if you're using the soft press. I'm not sure if they make that anymore. I've had it for quite a while, but that's all right. It's a, if anything, I think it's going to be helpful for those of you that don't have access to top quality papers because this is not behaving like one today. And I apologize for the little more burnt sienna in the ear for the sound of my furnace. It's getting cold here in Maine. I'll be moving upstairs before you know it. The brush I'm using is a Princeton No. 6 Cat's Tongue. It's synthetic. It's not a very expensive brush, but I like it because I can get a lot of detail. It's not flooding my paper with water. It's not as thirsty as my Mimics. Someone mentioned acrylics in the, I'm peeking at the comments here and there. If you wanted to do this in acrylics, I would paint your entire background. I would let that dry and then I would sketch on your deer and go from there. Okay, now if you wanted to, you could use masking fluid and you can mask out the sparkle in the eye. I am going to try to paint around it. I'm just going to go and blend my small Mimic Kalinske brushes. And I'm going to mix ultramarine blue. And I'm mixing it with a small brush because I don't want to get a lot of water in my mix. And I'm going in with burnt sienna. I'm going to mix them together and it's going to give me a nice natural black looking color. And I'm going to go in and I'm going to paint around that sparkle. I've got two little highlights in there. You could see that in the sketch on my website. If you want to right click on that, save it, and then print it out, you can. And something I find helpful is to get the lightest values and the darkest values in right off the bat, and then it's easier to kind of go through and get the rest. I could go and get the eyelash and eye right there, but I'm a little worried that it's still wet there. I'm not sure if my salt's going to work on this side of the paper. I'm going to be honest with you. So that might be kind of a bummer if that doesn't look good, but you'll know the technique. And if you try it on a paper with more sizing, it will work a little better. I'm going in, I'm also painting around the highlights on the nose. The reference photo is linked below. I am looking at the reference photo. Since it's from Paint My Photo, I can't share the photo itself on my on screen, but you can go and download it yourself. It is free for any artist to use and paint from. Just getting around that highlight there. Looks happy, doesn't he? I want to thank those moderators again. I see they're in there putting in links and helping people out. That's really wonderful. Goodness gracious, I wish the furnace would shut up though. I think this weekend I'm gonna turn over my office upstairs for winter painting mode. Mixing up a little bit more of that dark color. Just go real subtle. It's easy to make mouths look awkward on people and animals. So I'm just doing a little bit at a time. It's got some fur on his bottom lip there. So I just want to kind of keep that. You can also see his teeth a little bit. So just trying to paint around my lights at this point. And I've also got some kind of grays in here. So what I'm going to do is go back to the cat's tongue brush here and add some water in there. Get that to a nice gray. I don't want it too dark. I can always glaze over. And I'm going to put some of that on the top of the nose. happening in the darker shadows that I see. If I tap, I'm going to get the texture first, so I can do that. And don't worry if you get it, if it looks a little rough, because we can always do unifying glazes as we go. So don't worry about things looking a little rough. And something else you can always do is go in with colored pencil later if you feel like you just need a little more definition or texture, and you want to be able to adjust it a little bit more more carefully. You just want to make small. I almost said smally. I'm like, that's probably not a word. You want to make smally, tiny adjustments. I'm just putting in this kind of shadow color here. In the ears, there's a lot of that too. Just be careful if you're going up next to wet paint. You don't want it to fuzz out, because we do want this in focus. I kind of feel like I'm doing a paint by number because I'm just putting in dabs of color. All right, I'm gonna let that sit for a bit. I know I'm gonna have to do some more shadows, but I wanna work with some more of the warmer colors, get those midtones in there, and that's almost entirely burnt sienna. And I'm gonna go, I think I'm gonna go here. Let's go around the back. The back of the neck has a lot of this color in there. Ooh, have a paper towel handy, especially if you're working close to the background, because it wants to smudge. I'm not working with a lot of paint or water on my brush. You could get by with more water and paint on your brush if you're working on like an arches or paper with a good sizing. But I'm treat this very gently because I'm kind of in uncharted territory here. I should have copied it over on the other when I noticed it was on the wrong side, but I was lazy today. It's Black Friday. I'm feeling lazy. I'm feeling like I should be on vacation, I guess. You can hold your hand a little higher, and you can just kind of run the brush back and forth to get some fur texture that way too. And a little stronger color over here. Remember to keep preserving your white spots. If you have a fawn and it's got white spots, preserve that as you're going. Building up slowly, and when you do build up slowly, you can work on cheaper paper and still retain the detail. I'm wondering if there's any new people that haven't been here before, because it's a lot of people have the day off. It'd be interesting to say hi. Say hi if you're new. Don't be shy. Everybody's really friendly. I wasn't sure if I was going to do a live stream today, but then I thought, why not? I'm not going to go shopping. My husband has to work. Might as well. So these little strokes I'm putting in are giving me texture as well as color. Not adding a ton of color anywhere at once. Ooh, somebody said this got recommended on their front page on YouTube. That's awesome. I like a cat's tongue brush because it is very versatile. You can get a lot of different strokes from that one brush. I've had this one a few years. I think I paid about $5 at Jerry's for it. I was actually trying to find a bigger one in this line, but this is I think they only had 4 and 6s of the number 4050 CT. That's the line of this brush. It is a synthetic. They have ones in the Neptune range that aren't as sharp. They don't point as much. So it just depends on what you're going for. I don't want to go into a tiny spotter brush yet because I don't want to get too fussy yet. We're going to have plenty of time and room for those details. I'm still going in more for a wash. I thought this would be really pretty, and you totally have my permission. If you do this painting and it comes out beautiful and you think that it would be a lovely Christmas card or winter card, you have my permission to photocopy your design, have it printed, and then you could mount it on cardstock, send it out as a Christmas card. I think that would be really pretty. That's why I put the holly in the corners, because I thought that people might want to do that. Be pretty at a craft fair too, you know, because you can make up a bunch of those. People love to buy prints of greeting cards. If you're doing this and you want the deer in a meadow, when you're down here at the bottom, and like I'm kind of keeping this rolling line there, you would probably want to keep that a little choppier so you could go in with grass and pull them up. Like maybe just have some choppy strokes going down so you'd be able to pull some grasses up over the deer's body. Now I can dry brush here. My brush is just about out of paint, so I just started dragging it, and I was getting some nice texture of fur there on the neck. This burnt sienna has a nice glow to it, so it's just pretty warm. And I can kind of spread my bristles apart a little bit on my palette like that. If you look at my brush, see how I'm doing that? So that way I can have quite a bit of paint on my brush and still spread it out a little bit. And then I can pull some of those fur lines on the body as well. You can do that with any round or flat brush. I find that I get the taper of a cat's tongue just makes it really versatile. And of course, this is a regular synthetic. It's not as soft as like your Mimic, so it will retain those strokes a little bit better. And I'm making sure when I pat that paint on, I am going in the direction, like if I was to pet that deer, how my hand would go across the surface of the fur in that direction. And if I want to get those individual hair strokes, then I don't want to add too much water. So notice I'm just picking up whatever puddle I have on my palette. I'm not going into my water bucket when I want those strokes. I could pull a little bit off up here and cover up my pencil line. Quite subtle, just as long as you build it subtly, you shouldn't have too many awkward lines. All right, I want a little more yellow ochre. I think I'm gonna work in the face a little bit more. And my brush is a little wetter because I got into that water there. I don't want to have this too dark. And I'm going to soften this area that I've already put on. And just kind of glaze over some areas, kind of bring this closer to the eye. I always find if I'm going to go in with a new color or just like a darker color than what I already have, if I kind of go on the shadow first and then pull it off the shadow, I get an easier way to kind of integrate it in so I don't end up making anything too dark. There's a lot of subtlety here. And I'm gonna need to make some of those shadows darker, I can see already. I think I'm gonna take a little bit of rose, the quinacridone rose, and add it to that mix. It's just kind of almost like a blush pink now. And I'm gonna put some of that in the ears. So it's just a little bit of the quinacridone rose in that mix, yellow ochre and burnt sienna. And that's gonna go right in the ears. So, and if you lose your white little tufts in the ears, you can always go in with a colored pencil or a gel pen. A colored pencil might be a little bit better because a gel pen will be a little, might be a little too strong. So to kind of just keep that in mind. Going back in that gray that I had mixed earlier, I need to make a little more. I got ultramarine blue and a little burnt sienna. It's going to make a nice gray. You can get like kind of a sepia to a gray color that way. And I am going to work on the ears a little bit more now that the background's drier. Look at the subtlety in the reference photo. And I think I am going to switch over to my smaller brush right now and mix up some more of that dark. Just like we did with the eye, we went over to the smaller brush. This is a number 3-0 round. And it is the Mimic Kolinsky, so it's a little bit firmer than the Mimic Squirrel. You'll have a little more control. And I'm gonna start doing some detail around the eye. I think we're dry enough around there. And I'm gonna get this little eyelash over here. You can just see the edge of the eye over there. And I want to get some details in the ear before I get too carried away over there. And you can do the same thing we did with the cat's tongue. You can keep kind of working until your brush gets almost out of paint, and then you get that more texture and less brush stroke. So start in where you want it really dark and solid, and then just keep working until you run out of paint and go to more softer areas. Get a nice texture there. We'll do the same over here. Where I want it darkest will be right in here. I've got a nice... blotting my brush. I had a little too much on there. A little too much water. Not enough paint. Get that little bit of dark in there. Get that dark up at the tip. Oh, mumbling. Sorry, guys. Goodness, that furnace is on again. I have to start running the wood stove. That's quiet. All right. I'm adding a little water to my brush so I can mix up some more paint. I've got the ultramarine blue, burnt sienna again. Gonna need to reload my ultramarine blue. Almost out there. My goodness. Okay, so I'm going to start, and I can see I'm going to need a little more blue. I'm going to have a mix with a little more blue in it, because any place I need gray, more of a gray, I'm going to need that mixed with a little more blue. And I'm going to start up at the between the eyes, and I'm just going to do some little strokes here. And I'm gonna bring these strokes. These strokes are going with the direction of the fur, and they're gonna work their way over to near the eye, where we have that shadow there. And I'm gonna come back up here where I started, and I'm gonna work these little strokes down to the nose. And as I run out of paint, I'm pulling the brush strokes down around the snout a little bit more, so I can have a softer transition. And pick up a little bit of the browner mix. Go over this eye over here. I hope this isn't tedious. I know this is a little... I don't do wildlife very often, but after I did the squirrel sketch, I had a lot of people asking me to do some more wildlife, so I thought this would be fun. I hope you guys like it. The best advice I can give is if you're working on something, especially if it's out of your comfort zone, something you're not used to, if you can walk away from it and come back and look at it with fresh eyes, that way if anything's wrong with it, you'll see. And also if it's all right, you're going to see that too. It's harder to tell when you've just been working on something for so long. It's harder to tell how it's coming out. I'm going to water down the bluer mix. So it's a little more gray. It's not blue at all, but I'm going to go in under the eye. Oops, I need a little more water than that. And I'm going to pull this color down. You'll notice is even when there is white, you rarely see white on an animal. Usually seeing other colors too. A little more blue in that mix. And some water. Oops, I just got into the purple. I'm gonna have to mix that out again. Let's go over here. A little more blue. So what I'm going for is just kind of like the natural light shadow that you get outside. It's just a little bluer. And I wanna get some of that in the ear here. I'm gonna get some of that under the chin. This cast shadow. Some of this under the chin. Help define things. And over the nose. And now I'm going to look for any places I can use this color in the body, and I can see in the shadow over here, I can put some in. Mixing up a little bigger of a puddle here because I'm running low. Get that shadow in there. And I also want to put some down at the bottom of the body because that snow might be casting a shadow. We want him to look nestled in. Hopefully cozy warm, even though he's kind of hidden in a snowbank. Hopefully he's cozy warm. And that's going to help anchor him in the scene and give us a little contrast. If you do lose any of your white, you can always go in with a white gouache or acrylic paint later. Especially if you're going to reproduce it for a Christmas card, you know, all the texture will be the same after it's printed. So if you need to do that, then go ahead and do that. No art police is gonna catch ya. And now I want to go in with some a little more yellow ochre. There's a little bit of burnt sienna in that mix, but it's mostly yellow ochre. I just want to come over here and give it some texture on his hind end. All right. So now I want to dry this. So what I'm going to do is I am going to run my dryer on this. I'm going to look at the comments, and if any questions come in that that I can answer, I will do that while I'm running this machine here. I see questions about Paint My Photo. Paint My Photo is absolutely free. There's a link in the video description to the photos that I used. Just make a little account. You gotta make a username and a password, basically, and that's all there is to it. I'm glad everyone is helping out in the comments. That is really, really wonderful. Oh, I am getting a little bit of the snow effect that I wanted to. I still might spatter on some white gouache at the end, but I'm getting a little bit of the effect. You want to make sure your paper's dry before you brush off the salt, though. Oh, Martha says she wants to make a Christmas card with poinsettias. I have a tutorial on that on my YouTube channel, a watercolor, if you want to follow that along. right. Let me see if I can brush this off. Maybe I'll use a paintbrush to brush that off, actually, because if I have any dampness on my hands, I won't smear anything. Sometimes the salt wants to get stuck, but I think we're all right. A few little pieces. So it's not as the texture from the salt is not as good as if I would have used it on the right side of the paper, but I think we'll be fine. I will go ahead and probably spatter on some white later. I want to go into the other stronger colors that we have in this picture, even though we're not quite done the deer yet. I want to leave it be and let my eyes take a break from that. So I'm going to start by painting in the red berries. And I'm going to start with a mix of pyrrole red. If you don't have pyrrole red, use any warm red, like a cad red, deep, or scarlet, whatever you have in that department. And I'm going to take a little yellow ochre with that too, because I want this to be my lightest layer of my berries. And so go in and give each of the berries a wash of that color. You don't need your paint too juicy. In fact, my brush is way too full. You could use a regular synthetic for that if you want, if you're finding that you're getting way too much paint. I'm not using my fingers to paint with today, mostly because I'm going over a fairly light background and I know I want to build up glazes on this color. Excuse any noises of elephants you hear because the kids are upstairs. Well, two of them are anyway. These thin layers of color, these thin washes like this, these glazes washes are going to dry very quickly. So that's a nice thing about working in subtle layers. I like that color, though. I do like how it's kind of bringing out some of the colors in the deer. I think a lot of times when people are frustrated with their paints or their paper or their brushes is because they're trying to work against them instead of with them. I'm using this a little bit differently, like I mentioned, than I would if I was using an arches or if I had worked on the correct side of the paper. But that's all right because I decided I'm going to chill. I'm not going to stress. And I'm going to work with the pigment. I'm going to work with the paper. And you have to do that sometimes. We're all in different parts of the world. I've looked in the comments and I've seen people from the UK and people from South Africa and people from the United States. And we all have different supplies available to us. So it's important to make our materials work with the materials we have instead of fighting them. I think when I work with acrylics, I tend to fight acrylics a lot. I just need to be a little more chill when I'm working with. I need to treat them like watercolors, just chill out and do what they want to do. Okay, and if you decide you want any other colors, you can go ahead and do that. I kind of like how that color flooded kind of in there. I had some darker color and it flooded in there. So I'm going to see if I can force that look somewhere else because I kind of like how that looks. I don't know if that's wet enough, but I liked how it was not all the same shade. I thought that was pretty. So I'm going in with a damp brush and just softening the edges where I added that other color. One of those little surprise things that happen with watercolor that's so fun. There. All right, so we'll let that dry. While that's drying, let's do some glazes on our holly berries. So holly berries are more, let me clean this little area up here. They are a little bit more, I don't think you can see that spot in my palette. I'm just like shoving everything on my table, like out of the way. I won't be able to reach my water buckets. Holly leaves are very cool in temperature, but I don't want to add another green. So I'm going to use my sap green, but I'm going to add some ultramarine blue to it to cool it down. It's also going to make the intensity, take the intensity down on that color a little bit, which is all right because that sap is extremely almost neon bright. So that'll be our first layer. Okay, so you see how we got this color here? It's almost like a blue-gray green. It's very subtle. We're going to go ahead and put a little water in there. And this will be giving us our highlights. It looks a lot darker on the paper. I think it's because this paper is so absorbent. If anybody knows if they still make this, if Fabriano still makes soft press, or if they're only making the regular sheens now, I'd love to know. If anybody knows, let me know. Oh, I have a big splash of water there too. Let's take care of that. I can tell that paint is not going to lift up on this surface. Just where I blotted it there, I can tell that if that sits there for any amount of time, it's staying. Oh, somebody mentioned James Gurney in the comments. He's a very talented plein air painter. He's got some YouTube videos, just a lot of classes. Now, if I want to lighten something, it's not going to lift up completely, but I can lighten something if I want to just by pressing it. So that's an option. But if you are working on a heavily sized paper, you're probably going to take up more than you want. So we're just going in and filling these guys in. I was talking about milk paint. Boy, you guys have all kinds of conversations going on. Does anyone have any crafty things they want to get for Christmas? Anything they're hoping that they get? Let us know in the comments. Now this brush is the Mimic Squirrel. It is not a real squirrel. It is, but it's very absorbent. So I can do quite a few of these leaves with one brush load. Beginners might have a little trouble with the super absorbent brushes. And if that's the case, or if you feel like you're getting too much water in your paint, because if you're using student paints and really soft brushes with a lot of water, it can be hard to get the vibrancy that you want. So if that's the case, just get a stiffer brush and come back to these when you have a little more experience. They're a wonderful brush, but I think they can be frustrating for beginners. Same thing goes with like a Princeton Neptune or any animal hair brush, because they are juicier. Mixing up a little bit more. Again, that's the sap green. And our ultramarine blue. And water. Lots of water in this, because these paints are pretty concentrated. They're one of my favorite picks for beginner painters, because the price of them is like student grade, but they are professional grade paint. I like their 5 milliliter set of 18 for beginners, because it goes on sale sometimes I don't know what it's on sale right now for at Jerry's, but it goes on sale. I've seen it as low as $19.99 for the set of 18 colors. And you know, watercolor takes you a lot longer to get through than like acrylic. So you really don't need huge tubes to start off with. And then you can buy a big tube of whatever you run out of, like the ultramarine blue or sap green or whatever it is that you find that you use a lot of, instead of buying 18 tubes of big tubes of paint that you're not going to get through, you know, because if you don't use it, it's not a bargain. It's only a bargain if you're going to use it. And we're going to go up here and put our wash on these guys. I need to remember to cut down my paper cut down some boards for putting my paper on, because I have a hard time turning it when I have it on a big board like this without knocking other things down. Oh, okay, sure. Maisie's coming in. She's going to actually read questions for me. So if you guys have a question, type the word question in caps and my daughter Maisie will read it for me. Well, that's very helpful, honey. Thank you so much. Everyone say hi to Maisie. Maisie, say hi to everybody.
Hello.
any questions?
Yes. Okay. So, Domin Queen Designs.
Dominic.
Welcome all coming in. Please. She's trying to do something.
Yeah, she's probably reminding everyone to type the questions in all caps so that you'll, or type the word question in all caps so you can see it.
Okay. Hello.
And you can type too, but that computer's a little weird, so.
Yeah. Okay. Question from Linda Valdi. it went away.
Legit.
Wait, yeah. I have to scroll up. Okay.
Okay. You found it? There may be a few hiccups here, guys. I'm gonna use burnt sienna, and I'm gonna add some ultramarine blue to that to darken it up. And
okay, I found it. Does okay. Jerry's provide you a discount code?
Jerry's has a 15 to 30% off depending on how much you're spending right now. They don't give me like a specific one to share with you, but they do have some on there. Can't remember what it is. It's a Black Friday discount code right now for non-sale price items.
And another question. How to spell Maisy is M-A-I-Z-Y. Okay. What was the name of your paint set from the Real Mithril?
The Real Mithril? It's called the Turner Watercolor Set of 18, but it's the 5 milliliter one. They do make a larger one, and that one's more expensive, but honestly, I think I would just get the small 5 milliliter one. It's usually on sale between $29.99 and $19.99, so you can even like hold out a little bit and wait for a sale.
Okay. Another question is, what inspired you to do art?
I just have always done art. I had an art teacher growing up that lived across the field from us, and I used to go over there after school and on Saturdays and have lessons. So, and she was a great watercolorist. So I'm just kind of freehanding in branches where I think I want them. And I notice I missed a little piece of leaf there. That's going to be a darker color, so I'm just going to go in with a little bit of ultramarine blue, mix it in with some sap green, fairly cool, so it's more blue than green. And I'm going to go in and fill that area in that I missed.
Yeah, I might have missed some.
Oh, that's okay. Just I would just leave the page open.
I got to scroll to the bottom.
Did you scroll to the bottom? You not scroll to the bottom. We scroll to the bottom. And then if new questions come in, then Maisy will read them to me. Oh, goodness. I should have had you bring your computer down, but... Okay, there you go. Just don't touch anything, and the questions will pop up, okay? Okay, now I want to do some definitions. I'm going to let those leaves dry so we can put more glazes on after. I am going to turn my board because I want to approach it from a different angle. Just wait till I'm done saying something, okay, if you got a question to ask. I'm going to grab some of that purple that I mixed. That was ultramarine blue and the rose and a lot of water. And I'm going to put kind of a little line behind. Hopefully. Oh my gosh, it's hard to get this big board in frame here. Okay, go ahead and ask your question. I got to readjust some.
Well, someone asked me, do your sister and you do any art? Yeah, we have a YouTube channel and we haven't posted in a couple weeks just because it's been really busy, but we're going to try to.
Shameless plugging on my channel. Look at that.
Okay. And question, have you ever used Shin hand watercolors?
No, I haven't. I have them in my kind of cart. I've been thinking about picking some up. Anybody have any recommendations? I've heard mixed reviews on them. My friend Marty Owens doesn't care. He says he's not a fan of the Shin hand, and I really trust his reviews, and he's not crazy about them, but I do like to find things out firsthand. So let me know. If you guys have an opinion on them, please let me know. I'm adding some other colors in there because I'm not getting a good blend on this paper. So I'm letting kind of gravity help me. I basically just put the purple shadow on like where I had the little drift of snow going, and I'm just kind of letting the colors wick out.
Mom.
Yeah?
Someone wants you to do a review on Case and Paint. She finds them odd.
Oh, gosh, I don't have any Case and Paint.
And yes, I'm the one that plays the flute. My sister used to play saxophone.
Oh, I kind of like that blue on there. I'm going to do the same over here a little bit. Oh, I think I'm also going to pull a little bit of a shadow back here on this, what I think is kind of maybe a tree line. I'm just going to wet the paper a little bit because I need a little help in the blending department. I'm going to go with the burnt sienna, a little bit of ultramarine blue there, dip into the purple that I have, just trying to get colors I've already used.
Another question from Patty Piss. Picasso. What would you use to seal watercolor cards or distress ink?
I have rubbed them with wax and then heated them with a heat tool. Somebody just told me about a product called Dorland's Wax, and my friend Angela Fair just used it to seal watercolor paintings on her YouTube channel. If you want to check that out, it's a wonderful tutorial. I haven't received it. I ordered it I think I ordered it last week on Amazon, but I don't have Prime, so I'm kind of waiting for it. I just ordered a tiny tube of it. It's cheaper at Jerry's, but I didn't want a big jug yet, so I ordered just a tiny little container just to see if I liked it before I invested in the big jar of it. But I haven't used it yet. That's supposed to work really well, but I usually just rub it with some canning wax, and then that's what I have so far, and then just kind of heat it with a heat tool.
Someone asked, it went up, but how do you price your cards, I think?
It depends. I find it's odd because I spend more time on like a stamped crafted card than I do a watercolor card. My watercolor cards I sell for $7 because they're usually ones that I've done as a tutorial on YouTube. So I just kind of, I end up making a lot of them. So I had a lot of them. So that's kind of what I priced them at. It's probably not the wisest thing from an art standpoint to price them that low, but when you end up making so much stuff and you have so much, and I don't sell online, I just sell in a little shop, so that's what I price mine at.
Some questions about brushes. What would you use if you were beginning? And there was another one, I don't remember.
I think as a beginner, I would use a regular synthetic, and because I think that the Mimics are a little too juicy and might be difficult. The Royal Langnickel makes a line called Aqualon, and I like those, and I can show you an example because I do have some right here.
What brush are you using right now?
This is a Mimic Squirrel. It's a faux squirrel, but this is an Aqualon. It's got a plastic handle, and it's got the scraper handle, so I'll just demonstrate that right here. So you can actually, well, this paper isn't working too well, but you can scribe in lines like we do with a credit card scraper, or you can even push away paint and leave light white lines if you're working on a more sized paper. Pardon me, guys. I just got to scroll this computer. This is like my old computer, and it does not work very well.
Do you want me to go get my laptop?
You know, I don't think I would be able to sign into those without spending a lot of time. There you go. Just don't touch anything and just watch the things pop up, okay? You're doing awesome, though. Thank you, honey. Okay, and then maybe just to bring this foreground up a little bit more, I am going to just take some of the rose, quinacridone rose, and just like kind of tap it off so I just have a little hint of it, and add that to the snow in the front. So I don't know if you can see, it's just such a super light color. It's a lot of water, not very much paint, just to kind of blush up this snow in the front.
Me and Lyle are fraternal twins. How do you say it? We are not identical.
Fraternal twins. Yeah, so I'm not, she can't type on that computer. It's a very old, finicky thing. So so she'll have to answer things out loud. And I know my moderators will keep any trolls at bay. Okay, so now we're going to add some glazing on the leaves because they feel dry. We're going to mix up our sap green, and we are going to add ultramarine blue to it just like we did. We're going to make a stronger color, though. Now, if I was using like a student grade paint and I was trying to mix with these soft brushes, I would end up putting so much water in them that it would be frustrating and I wouldn't get the color that I wanted to get. I would just get this really weak color. So that's one of the issues I think that beginners have with the softer brushes. I think it's partially the paint that they're using, because heck, you're going to go through so much paint as a beginner, and I totally recommend starting off with student grade paint, like a Cotman, but you will have that issue with a softer brush. Now the holly leaves, they have kind of a glossy surface, so I'm just going to try to leave some kind of hard edged areas of lighter color. I just want to get my good definition. I want to cover up my pencil lines because I did make them a little darker than I like. Any questions, Maze?
Not really. I just, talked about how good you are at art. Yes, my channel is called The Crafty Twins. We haven't posted in a little bit, but I'm going to try to make some videos soon because it's vacation.
I don't know how my highlights are going to work out on these leaves. I might need to glaze over just like an ultramarine blue glaze after to kind of cool them down and give them more of the natural outdoor light color. We'll get our darkest shadows in and we'll see how they look after that. We'll see if they look too harsh. And if they're too harsh, we'll just go in and we'll put that glaze later.
Okay, question from Anne. Any suggestions on enlarging the little sketch?
What I do, and I have a Windows computer, a PC, so I don't know on a Mac. Maybe you could help on a Mac, Maisie, because you have a Mac. But what I do is I right click and save as. And then I open up that. I just like double click on it to open it up. And then it opens up in the Windows Picture Viewer. And then I just hit Control P. And then you can tell it to fill the page, or you can tell it to print like 5x7 or 4x6 or any of the generic standard sizes. That's what I do. So if you say like fill page, it should enlarge it to a 8.5x11 or so. Or you could say shrink to fit, and it will make it fit in like the size paper that you're using.
We have a couple more questions about watercolor. You probably have already answered some, but what is your favorite watercolor?
Boy, there's so many really good ones. I'm very partial to M. Graham, and I have a full palette of M. Graham. It's just the palette's so big that a lot of times I don't use it in videos because I want to be able to show the palette while I'm painting. But there are so many really good brands out there that it's hard to pick a favorite.
Missed the beginning. What brand of paint are you using?
I'm using the Turner watercolors. There is a teacher list in the video description. If you click on that, you'll see a list of all the products that I'm using.
Okay, and from the robot and her dog, are there any good watercolor books around, or can one learn everything from tutorials on YouTube?
You can learn a lot from tutorials on YouTube, mm-hmm. But my favorite watercolor book, and it's out of print, but you can get lucky and find it, is Everything You Ever Wanted to Know About Watercolor by Mary Apeloff. And I don't know if there's an ebook or version, but if you can get that, it's a humongous paperback, yellow watercolor book, and I love it. It's I opened it up. I've had it for years. I checked it out from the library, and I liked it so much that I bought a copy. And you know, I used to pull that off the shelf every few months and have a look at it. They don't print as many books as they used to. Oh, and if you like loose paintings, and of course I have to draw a blank. There's a British artist. I know one of you guys can tell me who it is. I can't remember her name, but she's beautiful. If anybody knows, put it in the comments, please. She's a British watercolorist, Jean Haynes, that's her name. She does beautiful, especially animals, in watercolor, and she will have like something in really tight focus and the rest of it will be so washy and loose, but you know exactly what it is because of how she, you know, focused just that one part of it. Jean Haynes has some really nice books. And she does online classes as well. I've never taken any of her classes, but I have seen some of her books, and they are fantastic.
Another question, it kind of went by, and I don't want to mess it up, but it said, do you prefer plain watercolor or airbrush? I'm not sure if that's the exact question. Does that make sense? Or
maybe she meant plain air painting?
Yeah.
Or maybe painting in studio? I like it both. I think that it's important to do both because you observe from nature and you'll involve more of your senses when you're plein air painting. And then when you go to paint in the studio, you're going to be more aware of how things really look. So you're building your visual vocabulary when you go out and you paint in plein air, if you can do it. I know it's not realistic for everyone, but I mean, even if you can just go to a local park, and it also helps you kind of get out of yourself because you can't be self-conscious when you're out there painting. You have to kind of just get lost in it and not worry if anyone's looking at you or and a lot of times people are curious and they want to see you do your thing, you know. It's a really great thing to try. Just try not to be too self-conscious and go out there and have fun.
There was a question. Can't find it.
if we missed your question, go ahead and repeat it. Like I mentioned, I have a really finicky old computer we use as a monitor computer. And once it scrolls by, it's really hard to get back to it again without losing everything.
Yeah, I try to type things, but I try to do it fast, and I mistype. And anyway, there's a question. I keep forgetting them.
It's okay.
It might come back to me. I'll try. Oh, yeah, I was going to say, if you have a question, it might be easier. If I see, yeah. This is what she said. If you just type question in caps and then write it, it will catch my eye easier, so we're more likely for me to answer it. I think, yes, Mom has painted our family. Or at least she's painted, like, self-portraits of us before. And it's really fun to watch because they're really cool and they look like us.
Oh, right. I do like the way these highlights are coming out. And we're going to put the shadows. We're going to put the shadows on this last one, and then we're going to go put another wash on the deer. So I've kind of let my eyes have a little break from that. Okay. So now I'm going to stick with this brush. This is one of my favorite brushes. This is the Mimic 8. It's a round number 8. Oh, and I want to share something with you. I know I've told you a million times, don't leave your brushes in the water. This is one of my favorites. This is the Mimic Kalinske 8. This is the Mimic Squirrel 8. And I left that in the water overnight. And what happens when you leave your wooden-handled brushes in the water is the wood swells and it splits the, because wood expands when it gets wet, and it splits your varnish or the paint that's on it. So that happened. And then it also made the ferrule loose. So today I actually used some liquid welder, any waterproof strong glue. I put them in the ferrule and I pushed the handle in, smooshed it all around. I actually used a skewer to get the glue around really good, let it set up on their own and push the ends together so I'd have a nice, so it'd be on there firm again. It's not as pretty as it was, but it does work as well as it used to. But try to just not do that. Try to keep don't leave your brushes in the water. I get very distracted and forgetful, and that happens to me. That's one of the reasons for the longest time I used only the brushes with the plastic handles, because I just couldn't be trusted with a good brush. I would leave it and it would get ruined. And then it would look awful, but you can get it back to usable quality. It's just best if you don't do that to begin with.
Me and Lila both really like art. I don't know about majoring in art, but, Lila probably more likely to do that. But we both really like art, but I don't know. It's, you know, it's still a long more time to, like,
before college, so let me ask you a college question.
I don't know.
Sometimes you need to read the questions, because if people are watching this later, they're not gonna know what this. The chat goes away. Okay, so I have a really washy amount of burnt sienna. I'm gonna mix them with yellow ochre too. So I'm just adding yellow ochre and water. I have it in a different well that's a little off camera, but it's just a really watery yellow ochre. I'm gonna start with yellow ochre because it's lighter, and I am going to go. I'm gonna start at the bum end of our deer. And I'm going to do this really light wash of yellow ochre. Try to avoid the spots if you can. If you do get some of the spots, it's not the end of the world, but try to avoid it. Now, it's kind of like we're doing a controlled wash. We're bringing the paint over. Okay, so we still have this wet edge. We're going to try to keep just one wet edge at a time so we don't have hard lines. And now I'm going to pick up the burnt sienna. I'm going to go right into that wet edge. And I'm going to pull it over, keeping my highlights, keeping my spots, rather.
Why are watercolors your favorite?
Because I like how quickly I can sit down and start painting. I don't have to set up a palette. I don't have to really do anything other than open the lid on my palette and have a bucket of water and I can start painting. I like that instant gratification. There, now all of a sudden that looks a lot more natural because we've just pulled that unifying wash across. I'm gonna keep on going. I'm gonna stick with that burnt sienna, bringing that wet color across. I'm gonna go up to the throat here. Now, when I get to that white area, I'm cleaning my brush. I'm gonna grab a little bit of that gray that we made, super watery though. Blot a little bit so I have some control, and I'm pulling that over with just that gray. Gonna go back to the yellow ochre. So if you watch my "What is this brush for? Used for?" video, you see a controlled wash, and I mentioned that you can change color as you go across from the controlled wash, and that's what we're doing. I didn't do a really big bead because I wasn't tipping this. I was just staying in a small area. I went over a spot there, so I'm gonna see if I can blot that up and get it back. I'm Okay. Now that we've done that bottom part, we've got our kind of our feet wet, we're going to go up onto the face of it. And we're going to start with the yellow ochre again. We're going to start right on that wet edge. We're going to work our way up. Go over. We're up near the eye. I'm going to rinse. Going to pick up some of that gray that we made to go over by the eye because that's a whiter area. And this is going to get, this is getting ready, rid of any of our harsh lines. And just keep pulling that wash up. And we can go over this light area there too, because there's not really a white spot there. I'm going to go into the ear with this brown. And anytime you're feeling confused or overwhelmed in a painting, take a break, go walk away, look at it in a couple hours or the next day, and you'll see clearly what the painting needs. If you don't have that time, maybe you only have a certain amount of time to paint a week, look at it in a mirror, hold it up to a mirror, and that will give you a fresh eye on that. All right, now while that wash is drying, we're going to go onto the berries, and we are going to go with rose, and our quinacridone rose, and our pyrrole red. Mix that right over here. And we're going to go in and add some shadows to it, especially like the berries that are kind of in back. I think I'm going to switch to a smaller brush though, because that's holding so much paint that I think I'm going to get myself in trouble there. A little water on that. Any more questions coming up, Maisie?
Nope.
Okay.
It's weird though, because when you're talking, there's a bunch of questions, and then when no one's talking, there aren't, and then I can't say them anymore. So if you guys have any questions, you can ask them.
If you have any hard lines on the berries, you can blot them. That you've got your shadow on. You'd have shadow like where something is right up underneath a leaf that would be more shadowed. Then you could soften the edge so it looks a little more round and natural. So if you look at that versus these over here, see how it has a little bit more roundness and depth. I need to mix up a lot more of that color. I'm using it up really fast, so I'm just going to make a bunch of it.
Question, what brushes to use for beginners? I know you have some.
There's any regular synthetic that's suitable for watercolor is fine. The Royal Aqualons are nice. The Ebony Splendors are nice.
Some people are asking if you pause the thing.
Oh, are we frozen or buffering? Well, let me know in the comments below if you're experiencing buffering. It looks fine on my end, but I'm just seeing kind of the YouTube dashboard. So let me know if it looks all right or if we're having issues, please. And Maisie, just let me know what they say. Okay.
I don't know if that's for this.
What?
Not buffering for me. Okay, I think it's good now.
It might be your individual internet connections, and if you play it back, it should be fine.
Okay. What is your favorite student grade watercolors? Asked by Jackie.
Grumbacher Academy is really good. Van Gogh is really good. Sonnet by Yucca St. Petersburg is really good. Cotman's really good and easy to find. Yeah, those are all safe bets.
Okay. Okay, it's all working now.
Oh, good. Good. Sometimes we have little hiccups. I'm sure there's a lot of people out there Black Friday shopping. They're messing up with our live stream. Mm-hmm. Dividing up our bandwidth. It's probably all you guys' kids are at home playing games or something and making your YouTube buffer.
Okay. Question from Astrid M. Wheeling. I'm bad at pronouncing names. Question, if you were stuck painting with only acrylics for oils for a week, which would you choose?
Oils. I love oils.
Okay, what, from Kevin Crispo, what compact color palette do you recommend?
Oh boy.
Well, it depends on your budget. Probably if you're on a budget and you want quality for very little money, there's a couple I would recommend. The Lucas Studio is like $10 right now. I'm thinking about buying a bunch for my summer workshops. They're a little bit more opaque than the Turners. That's the only thing I'm thinking about, why I'm like kind of wondering whether I'm going to do it or not. And also I like Prima. They're very inexpensive. They have a nice, their palettes, for the price of the paint on the Prima watercolors would be what you pay for just the metal tin palette they come in. So that's kind of a good deal. The Lucas 1862s, the set of 12 is like $23 right now. So that's a pretty good value too. And that's artist quality, but I find their student grade to be almost as good as their artist quality. So, so $10 versus $23, I guess is the real question, what you want to spend. Because those all come in their own little palette. So you don't have to go and buy a palette separately. They come with them. And you can always, refill them with other paints when they run out. So I kind of like that. I'm also liking the Mission Gold Perfect Pan set. That's a lot more expensive. That's right here. I think it's about $112 at Jerry's. But I just made a little swatch because the colors are so transparent that they look almost black in the tins. So what I did was just made a little swatch and put it in like a little bookmark sleeve, and I keep it in there so I can tell what my colors are, because otherwise they look black because they're so transparent. I really love that. The only thing is, opened up, if I don't have a really good place to sit and paint, it takes up too much space. So I like a 12, like the regular 12 size half pan palette for travel, just because sometimes I'm sitting on a rock and I have no place to lay out my palette. I have to hold it, and it's just too hold. You can't hold that.
From The Real My Thrill, what are the most useful mimics and who makes them?
They're made by Creative Mark, which is Jerry's Artorama brand. The set, this is a squirrel set. I think it might be 8. Those have probably the most useful color, the most useful sizes, but I would say I'd go with a number 8 round. If you could only get like a couple, go with a number 8 round and like a number 4 round or a number 5 round. And then if you wanted to add to that, I do love the number 30 round for washes. You wouldn't need a big flat if you had this one, because you can also paint with it. And I like to start a painting with a big brush like this because you can't get too fussy. So I would probably go with these three. These are all part of a set with this big wash and this little brush. And I think there's a couple others. Yeah, there's these as well, a liner and a number 12 round, which is also useful. And there's also another flat. I think they're all right here. These are all available in a set. I can't remember offhand how much that whole set was, but if you know you're getting a few of those, it might be cheaper to buy the set than to buy them individually. They're all very useful, but those three would be the ones I use the most.
From SigFam, what is your recommendation for good quality but inexpensive paper?
It depends on what you're painting. The Strathmore... and we're going to do that. We're going to do that ultramarine blue wash on these, on the leaves. Just really, really thin down ultramarine blue. Inexpensive paper. Strathmore Wind Power is, if you're not doing a lot of glazing, I like that because it can handle a lot of water. I like the Aqua Bee 140 pound. If you are going to do a lot of glazing, that's very affordable. They have 6-inch by 9-inch sheets and 50 sheet pads. I see them for around $20. So that's kind of hard to beat. For rubber stamping, that I'm going to watercolor, I like the Canson XL watercolor pads. Those are like 30 sheets for about $6. And those are 9x12 sheets. And then, if you are going to spend a lot of time on something, I do recommend like splurging using a Fabriano Artistico or Arches, because it can take the wear and tear of many glazes. It just can hold up to it a lot better without pilling. I mean, this is an Artistico, but I'm working on the wrong sheet, the wrong side, but it's withholding it. It's not as heavily sized as the right side of the sheet, I've noticed, which I've never found to be the case with Fabriano, but this is also the soft press line, so I don't know if they still make that. This was an older sheet that I had. So just match the paper and the expense of the paper to how much time you're going to spend on it, what techniques you're going to do to make sure you're kind of putting your money where it matters.
Who inspired you to do watercolor and art?
Watercolor, probably my art teacher, but my mother was one that signed me up for classes, so that was probably the biggest inspiration. I want to do some more details on my on the deer. I'm going to switch to a smaller brush because I am going into details. And I'm going to start, I think, with the face and work my way around. I'm going to mix up brown with a teeny bit of red in it. I basically just want to kind of pink it up because there is like just a little area on the edge of the lip and in the mouth. I just want to kind of warm that up a little bit. And then while I'm at it, I'm going to take a little bit of that color into the ear. And get the hairs while I'm at it. Go ahead.
From Lim Pellet, have you ever tried Reeves watercolors?
Reeves? Yes, I've used the tube Reeves before. I used to teach with that for kids because it was so affordable. And it was just really good for techniques with children who where they're learning to mix and they're just going through so much paint. And I've used it with some adult students too. There's nothing wrong with it. There's a lot more filler than like than other artist grade paints, but you know, they are very economical. I'm also taking that color. I'm doing a little bit over the eyes and a little bit on the edge of the snout, warming it up a little bit and giving it a little bit more life. Just it's very little. You don't want the fur to look pink, but you do want to just get that warmth in there.
From Bev Roberts, question: does Jerry have their huge watercolor paper in block sale the same time every year? It seems they had a great one last spring.
I don't know if they repeat the same sales, but if you sign up to get their catalogs, they always send out a like that kind of the super duper sale catalogs like every couple of months, like every season it seems like. Doing a little watered down ultramarine blue in the nose just because that's the highlight. You would see that highlight is from the like the natural sky color, and I'm doing that on the lower lip as well.
From Kevin Crespo, at what price would you sell a watercolor painting that's 9 and 12?
Well, for me, I know a lot of people have standard pricing, but it kind of depends on how much time I've put into it. I usually sell them for around 50, but it depends. I mean, if it's something that I just kind of whipped up in no time, it would probably be a little less. And that's also considering I sell in a like a small town store, I don't really do my stuff online, so probably could get more if I put up a online shop, but I am definitely not the go-to advice on art pricing because I have a hard time. It's hard to price your art, I think.
What was the favorite thing you painted?
Oh gosh, I don't know. I really like the pears I did a few weeks ago. I really had fun painting that and the blue jay feather. Those are recent favorites. Oh, and the 5 seashells. Those are going up tomorrow on the YouTube channel. I had a lot of fun painting that. I don't know.
Yeah, guys, sorry if I have been skipping your questions because it's hard to scroll up and then scroll back down and mom might be talking and might be going out of the range where I can see them, so I'm trying to answer as much as I can when she's not talking. So
you're doing great.
Okay, and Jack, yes, what was your I've already asked you that. Okay, can I use acrylics over watercolor, and can I use watercolor on canvas?
You can use acrylics over watercolor, no problem. You can use watercolor on a canvas if you use either get a watercolor canvas or you use a watercolor ground. Daniel Smith and Golden both make watercolor grounds. I've used the Daniel Smith one. Daniel Smith one works great. I've never used the Golden one, but Golden's a good company, so I can't imagine that it wouldn't work well as well. This dark that I'm putting in is a mix of burnt sienna and ultramarine blue. I haven't added any new colors that we haven't been using all along.
From a Moonlight G question, what's the cheapest watercolor that's actually good?
Well, that really will depend on where you live, because I don't know where everybody... what's available everywhere, but it's hard to beat the price of the Turner, which is what I'm using right now. Like 15 milliliter tubes start at $325 on sale at Jerry's, so it's really hard to beat that. Da Vinci is also a very affordable brand that's high quality. I enjoy Da Vinci. Van Gogh is decent, and so is Grumbacher Academy. They're very affordable. Those are more student grade paints, but they do perform well and they're light fast. Lucas is, I have never tried their tubes, but their pans are very affordable.
Question from Eva. Can WC paints get old? I don't know what that stands for.
Watercolor paints.
Okay. Yep. Teacher was upset with me because I used my dad's old rebrand skin kick pan set.
A schminky pan. Well, your teacher really, I'm surprised and a little upset that your teacher was mad at you because watercolors do not go bad. I mean, unless they get moldy or something, but that rarely happens. Schminky paints are some of the best paints on the market. And they don't go bad. They're absolutely fine. If they don't have mold on them, go ahead and paint with them. A lot of them are probably better than they are now. Sometimes pigments have improved because there are a lot of synthetic pigments that are more light fast than their natural counterparts. But no, they are fine. They are fine. Even if they get hard in the tube, cut the tube away and use it. I've got some paints that are from the 70s that are fine. I got a palette one somebody gave me because they found it in their, grandmother's attic, and the grandmother passed away, and they didn't have any use for it. And it was full of paint. It was an old John Pike palette, and the paints are perfect. So no, the paints are fine. Use them.
Question from Jackie. What is your favorite watercolor palette?
For a studio palette, meaning one that's going to stay in the studio. By the way, I'm just taking that same color and a little brush and flicking on some little hairs down here. I recommend the John Pike palette because it's so durable. It's going to last longer. It is a plastic palette and it will just kind of discolor, especially if you leave it in the light. I'm adding a little more burnt sienna to this color. This ultramarine blue burnt sienna mix. I really like that. I also like the Jones palette, but it's a little more brittle. I think now they're about the same price, but it was a thinner plastic and it was cheaper when I bought it than the Pike by quite a bit, by probably like $10. Well, which was quite a bit when I was, 20 years old. But it's held up fine. It does yellow a little bit, but it's not enough to like make my mixes off. Some people like porcelain palettes for in studio, but I'm just afraid of dropping them and they're heavy and they're really expensive.
Okay. Question from, if I can find it. Okay. From Kevin. Do the core watercolor paint act differently from regular watercolors brands because of their binder?
I don't find them to act much differently. They have a lot of flow and they're super vivid and a little goes a long way. But I've used them with other brands. They're fine. I really enjoy them. I recommend them. They'll work fine with the other paints. It seems like you need less, like a little goes a long way. They kind of remind me of the Mission Golds in that respect. I'm very gently elongating some of these strokes to kind of give the fur a little more direction and just kind of add that shadow to the bottom of the deer, break it away from the ground a little bit. And we're using the small brush so we don't do anything too crazy and we don't make any really big adjustments. We're just small adjustments here. And you know this paper is really grabbing the paint when I can't lift burnt sienna up off of the surface. I'm going to go in, add a little more ultramarine blue to that to gray it down. I'm going to do a little more texturing on the chest of the deer, and you could do this with a rake if you had a rake brush. Just you'd also want to use a round brush too so that you don't end up with all brush strokes looking the same. Yeah. Any more questions?
Well, there are some questions like a long time ago up there, but you were talking, so I can ask them. But yeah, if I didn't answer questions, you guys can just leave it again and make sure you type question in caps before you do it. Just so it's a little easier for me to catch my eye on it.
And the moderators do a really good job at answering questions too, which is very helpful.
Thank you, moderators.
I am going to need a bigger brush there because, and a little yellow ochre because I got a little dark in there. All right, we're just about done here. I'm going to bring a little bit more of the reddish. I'm adding a little red into my burnt sienna mix. Because I really feel like this needs to be a little brighter over here.
Okay, question from Astrid. Have either of you ever tried making henna art? Sorry, not related to watercolors. I don't think I have.
No, I haven't. That's like you do that on the hands. It's kind of like that tattoo. stuff. No, I've never done that.
I don't know if I've heard of it before.
I think sometimes they do it, like, when we went to Storyland, I think there was a booth, like, some people that did that at Storyland, like, with the face painter, near the face painter people.
Oh, that thing?
Yeah.
Okay. I have two questions for you.
Okay.
Do you want me to ask them?
One at a time, please.
Do you prefer detailed or loose paintings?
Usually loose. But I don't know, I like both. I like to challenge myself.
And question, have you tried Art in Minnow? It's a social media site, especially for artists.
No, I haven't. I don't really, I'd rather be painting than talking about painting. I find it very difficult to keep up with the social media that I have already committed to. So I haven't, just because I haven't really had the time to jump in and start anything new without completely neglecting the people on the platforms that I've already got going, so.
And someone asked if you could show some of your paintings from when we were younger, maybe some other time.
Me? Yeah, I don't think I have any paintings from when I was younger. I don't really keep them around. Maybe my mother does. I don't know.
This girl named Grace, her problems aren't, her questions aren't coming through when she asks them.
Huh.
I don't think, because I haven't seen any of them. But
I don't know. Huh. Okay, so we're going to do one more layer on the berries. I think our deer is just about done here. Oh, maybe a little bit, something on the face. That looks a little too rough there, so I think I'll wash.
Yes, my mother does have Instagram.
Yep.
What is it called?
Lindsay Wyrick.
Yep.
So, at Lindsay Wyrick.
Yeah, she has stuff about posts.
I love the way you say, yes, my mother's Instagram. She's the uncoolest person ever.
Okay, I see Grace's question. I'm waiting for my Sennheiser travel set to arrive. Have you had a good experience with those?
I have, yes. I'm making a shadow for the berries. I'm using ultramarine blue and rose, quinacridone rose, and I'm mixing it on top of that last berry color just so I don't get it too different from what I already had. I just want it slightly different. And I'm going with a small brush, and I am just going to add some, like, last shadows on them. And since it's not too, it's just slightly different, I'm not going to fuss around with too much blending. I'm just going to kind of put the shadows in. Yeah, the Sennheiser travel set's really nice. They have a deal going right now where it's buy 12, and it's still going. This is what I bought. It was the buy 12, get 6 free, so you get 18 for the price of 12, and you get a palette that has room for 6 more half pans in it, which I have not filled. I don't think I'll put more Sennheiser in them. I think I'll put Schmincke or some of the other, maybe the core half pans that I have, because Sennheiser has a much more muted look to it.
What color watercolors do you, like, brands do you like to use, and what are your, like, your favorites of all the ones that you have?
I have a whole playlist of product reviews. I would go look at that, because I have so many, I've tried so many, and I like so many, and I know I'm gonna leave somebody out if I just try to rattle them off at the top of my head. There are so many good brands. Pretty much, if you stick with a name brand, you're gonna have a decent paint. But different, there are different properties. Some are more opaque, some are more transparent, some are more muted, some are more vivid. It depends on what you like. Everybody's a little different. Some people don't, you know, Mission Gold, I love Mission Gold. Some people hate them because they're so bright that they think they look a little artificial. So I would look at the reviews and see when you're looking at it, what makes you say, yeah, I want to try those. And other things are going to make you say, oh, I don't think those are for me. You know, that's how I make decisions before I purchase too. I look at people's reviews. Marty Owens Art on YouTube, he's got fantastic reviews. So, and he's tried almost every brand out there, and I don't always agree with him, but I agree with him a lot. And so does Steve over at Mind of Watercolor. He's got a lot of really good reviews too.
Yeah. And, someone else asked, and yes, I'm 12 years old. And you just want him, right? Where do you get, like, knowledge of art?
A lot of it's trial and error. I took lessons when I was a child, but, it's been a lot of trial and error. I'm using burnt sienna with a little ultramarine blue. You're probably sick of hearing me say that, because I've explained that mix a bazillion times. I'm going to put a few little branches just kind of tucked in behind our little deer here. So it's kind of like He's kind of hidden in a little thicket. So I'm using, you'll notice, oh, this is something I want to explain too. So this is a spotter brush. I'm not going to get a lot of paint on this. So if you want a lot of control, that's why we used it, like putting details on our deer. It's a great option for that. But because it is, the bristles are short and there's not a lot of bristles, it's not going to let me bring a lot of paint to my paper. So if I want that skinny line, what I can use is a liner. And I got one right here. It's just kind of, I just had it out a second ago, so I know it's right here.
Can I ask you?
Yeah, go ahead.
Well, just quickly, can you answer what's your favorite watercolor color? And then I have
favorite watercolor color. That's, oh, there's so many, but I really like cobalt teal. That's probably one of my favorites because it granulates and it's a beautiful color. It's a single pigment too. So I can really hold a lot of paint here, and I could do almost like a ton of shrubs. I don't know, I could do many strokes here. Can nestle my little deer right, and this isn't great for mixing because the bristles are long and floppy, but what I can do is add a little bead of paint and I can draw from that. You just have to be careful, you don't have as much control here, so it's really easy to go beyond that little snowdrift that we have in there.
Okay,
do maybe a few on the other side too to balance it out. Just kind of nestle him into his little environment.
Thank you for saying I love your channel. Yeah. And if you guys want some Christmas videos, we're going to do some. So
I've got a Christmas bauble ornament coming up, Christmas bauble wreath coming up. You have any Christmas projects you're planning, Maisie?
I don't know. I might want to. You guys can also like do suggestions, but I kind of want to maybe make some ornaments, or you know the thing that you did with the drawing, you know, stenciling out like the mistletoe and thing.
Oh, the tags?
I don't know what it's called, but yeah.
Were they gift tags?
Actually, I don't think so, but
I have no idea what you're talking about.
Okay, well, you know.
No, something I don't. Pretty. Something pretty. That's good. Should I put berries on these branches, do you think, Maze? Should there be little berries on the branches that I'm putting here?
A few. Not too many, because you already have some berries.
That's true.
Ask them if they want berries.
What do you guys say? Should we do berries, people? I don't know. See, tell me if they want berries. I gotta find something to bury it with. I use my little dot stylus. That would work. Use my little dot stylus here. Any?
No, but there also, I think there's a delay.
There is a delay. There's like a 30-second delay. I'm going to do some berries. I think what I'll do is I'll just dip it right in that pyrrole red. And I'm not going to leave this brush in the water.
We're having some no berries and some yes berries.
Oh, okay. Well, I'll just do a few then. I'll look at that. This is a ball and stylus. If you don't have one of these, you can save an old dried up ballpoint pen. But I'm going to see, I'm using the large end. And I'm just sticking it in my thing of paint. We have all these little branches around our house, and like in the ditch by the side of the road. They're just all these little branches with berries. They're so pretty because all the deciduous trees have lost their leaves, and all you see is these shrubs with all these berries, and they're so pretty.
Have you ever used whole bean watercolors? There's more of the question, but
yes, I really like them. I got a set, and you kind of have to be careful if you buy a set though, because you'll get a lot of mixed pigments. And even though they're pretty and bright, I prefer to have single pigment colors if I can. So I wasn't happy about that. I got the 18 set, which was, I don't know, $32. That one was from Amazon. It was nice to try it out, but I think you'd do better to get them at an art supply store and buy just the colors that you want and make sure that you're not getting mixed pigments. Because when you start off with pure pigments, you can mix more colors and your colors will be more vibrant.
Mommy, just berries, no splatters.
Just berries, no splatters. I thought about splattering on some snow, but nobody wants the splatters.
Tie the berries to the holly on the sides.
Tie the berries to the holly?
The berries need to tie into the holly.
Tie into the holly. Well, those hollies are kind of like as decorations on the front, so I wasn't intending to make them like to scale. They're kind of bigger. I'm looking for a sea sponge. I think I might want to sponge on some moss, because give the deer something to eat. Oh, here we go. I got a sea sponge right here.
Mom, what would you do if you didn't have art?
Oh, I don't know. I'd be a radio DJ probably, because that's what I did before. I wouldn't want to think about what I'd do without art. I'm going to use a little sea sponge here, and I am going to just try to get a little bit in the sap green, just the tip. I'm going right on my pan of color, and I'm just going to sponge on some moss and lichen.
And one person said that'd be cool if we did like a daughters and mother tutorial.
Oh,
like,
yeah?
If we could get Lila to do it with us, that'd be cool. Like, you know, we could paint something.
Oh, that would be fun.
Yeah, and we could put it on my channel. I'm kidding.
We could do a gingerbread house. I bought a gingerbread house, actually, for you guys to decorate. A little set of four minis.
Mm-hmm. We could all do one.
I actually just bought a new spatter brush to spatter. I thought it might be nice for snowflakes. I don't know. They said, who said no spatter anyways? Was it Rich Moden, the spin doctor? Was he the one that said no spatter?
Yeah, probably. Yeah, that was him. But then other people are like, I do like splatter. Also, another question by Kevin. Was the painting inspired by the movie Bambi?
No, it wasn't. That movie's sad. I don't like that movie. I'm going to use a little, I am going to use a gel pen to do highlights on the berries here. This is a Uniball Signo. It is my favorite gel pen.
The spin doctor said, Miss Wire, don't you dare splatter.
He's not the boss of me.
I do a lot of art, and I'm not doing as much during the school year as I did during the summer, just because, you know, we're getting a lot of projects and for school and stuff. But yeah, I do a lot of art. Question from Tisa. Just bought Prima metallic watercolors. What would you use them for? Need some inspiration.
There's some really bright ones. I would use them on dark paper or over dark painting. So if like you did like a crow, like a painting of a crow or something, or any sort of bird with iridescent feathers, you could go over that with the Primas and like the purples and the blues, if that's a set you got, and you can add the sparkle. For the other ones aren't as bright. Those you can kind of just mix in with your colors and they'll give like a very subtle sheen. I think I'm going to go in right on, even though I saved up my highlight, I'm going to go in and add a little bit more, and I'm going to brighten up my highlights with a gel pen since I've already added it. I think it's going to add a little bit more life in here, and I can go in and I can do the, hairs in the ear. You don't have to do this if you don't want to do this. I just feel like since I was on the wrong side of the paper, it lost a lot of its luminosity. So I'm going in and just throwing little hairs in. You can bring back any spots that you might have lost. I'm not going to do it all because I did manage to keep some of my white spots just fine. But I just felt like it needed a little bit of pick me up, and I can also do snowflakes. And since I'm not spattering, I'm using the gel pen, I can put them wherever I absolutely want them.
Question from Kevin. Do you like the Karen Datch water brush?
You know, that's one of those things where some people, it's their favorite one. I liked it at first, but then it seemed like I couldn't get the plunger to release my my water very well. I think it's a little overcomplicated, quite frankly. It does seem to be really well made. It's definitely like one of the most complicated ones I've seen, but no, it's not one of my favorites, actually.
What are your favorite watercolor pencils?
I like Albright Drawer watercolor pencils. The Caran d'Ache Supercolor are good. They also have the museum. I haven't used the museum ones. They're more expensive, but those are nice. For a budget, the Reeves watercolor ones are pretty good. I'm going to add a little branch up here. I just feel like this is just floating in space and it's a little weird.
What does it mean for paint? I don't know if it said paint because it went up, but if it's a single pigment or more than.
It means that the paint is made out of just the color portion of what makes up the paint just has one pigment in it, like PB29 for ultramarine blue or PBR7 for burnt sienna. It just means that it's made with a single pigment, and those colors tend to be brighter because they haven't, every time you mix a color, you mix another color in, it kind of takes down the intensity a little bit, and then you don't have that problem if it's a single pigment colors. Some pigments aren't very intense, like your iron earth pigments, but a lot of ones are much more intense if you stick with single pigments. I think this does it. What do you think, May? Does that look done to you? I should take the tape off, and you can see the white border, except for where I smudged green on it. Let me sign my name. See if there's any more questions, Maisie. Will I sign my name? And then we'll take the tape off and we'll...
Okay, question. What water brushes do you like?
I did a whole video on water brushes. I would suggest looking at that because then you can tell for yourself what you like the best. There's a lot of really good ones there. And there, I don't find a huge difference between many brands. But if you look at that video, you'll see the subtleties between them. And you can decide, you know, if it's... If you're... Some differences, like there might be a big difference in price, but there's not a huge difference in the brush, you know. So you have to decide what's good, right for you.
Have you done a review of Daniel Smith Primatech?
Primatech?
Yeah.
No, I haven't. I only have two of their Primatech colors, and I got them as sticks, and I like them, but I don't. I feel like I need a bunch of them. I'm going to review something. I don't think it's fair to review something based on two colors. But I do find that I have one of their samples charts, and I find them, the little dot samplers, I find their quality to be really good, and they're USA made.
And I listen to like a bunch of different kind of music. What kind of music do you listen to, Mother?
I listen to a lot of different kinds. I'm not a fan of pop or country, current pop or country, but I like folk music. I like, you know, older like 80s new wave music, like The Cure and, you know, Depeche Mode and U2 and Elvis Costello and that sort of thing. And this, I smudged my finger in the Viridian paint, and I got it on the border, and then I tried to lift off what I could, and when I put my artist tape down, the paper was still damp, so the paint did seep in under there. So that's why you want to make sure you put your tape down on dry paper. I didn't really have time. I had to kind of get that done and tape down, but there is the finished painting.
Yay.
All right. I want to thank everybody that hung out today. Maisie, thank you so much for coming down and helping out with questions.
It was fun.
And if you have any questions that I didn't get to, then go ahead and type them in the comments as soon as the broadcast is over, and I will hang out in the comments for a bit and answer your questions. I do appreciate you taking time out of your Black Friday, and I hope that if you go out and brave the stores that you find everything that you were hoping to find and that it's not stressful. Thank you so much for watching. Please leave a thumbs up before you leave today. That really helps my channel. Please check out our sponsor, jerrysartarama.com. They have an amazing sale going on right now. And if you Google stocking stuffers, you'll find all these $1 and $2 try-it items. I know that the Mimic Kalinskis are one of the try-it items. They have a tube of alizarin crimson. Turner watercolor is a try-it item. There's some pastels. There's wonderful painting panels. A lot of things you could try it before you invest a lot of money in it, which I really like. And also, if you're looking for online classes, Craftsy has their biggest sale of the year right now. Every class is $17.99 or less. My class is only $13.99. That's Mix It Up, Mixed Media Step by Step. There is a link in the video description. And any class you purchase after clicking my special discount link, it will help support the free tutorials I do here on YouTube, and I do appreciate your support.
Yeah, and thank you everyone that said thanks, Maisie, because you're welcome.
Awesome. Okay, guys, thank you so much for watching.
Bye.
And happy crafting.